So good morning. My name is Sol Berman. I'm the University of Michigan's Chief Information Security Officer. And on behalf of the university, ITS, and Information Assurance, welcome friends and colleagues, old and new, for the keynote for Summit 22, one of the longest running higher ed IT security symposiums in the United States. For over 15 years, Summit has brought together faculty, researchers, practitioners, and recognized experts to share knowledge on timely IT security and privacy issues. Higher education in general, and the U of M in particular, are well positioned to tackle these complex and challenging topics. Here, we're privileged to support research that strives to solve the IT security and privacy challenges of today and tomorrow. And we support the teaching of the young minds and future leaders that will have to face an exciting and increasingly perilous digital future. Having the opportunity to be a part of this discourse is why many of us work for or are part of the University of Michigan community, and it's definitely why I'm here. Today's topic is particularly pressing, no pun intended. Ensuring that journalists and other at-risk or exposure-sensitive populations are protected can literally mean the difference between life and death. And with all that out of the way, let me tell you about today's event. We're excited to have Runa Sandvik, a security technologist who's been long focused on security for journalists, present to us. And her presentation will be followed by a conversation between Runa and Elodie Vialle, journalist, former University of Michigan Knight Wallace Fellow, and now a Berkman Klein Fellow at Harvard working on digital safety and free expression issues. So get ready for a fascinating hour, prepare some questions for the Zoom Q&A, and tweet along with us at UMich Tech. That's UMich, T-E-C-H Tech. And with that, Runa, please take it away.
Thank you, and good morning, everyone. Thank you, Sol, for the introduction and for inviting me. Let's see, I'm just kind of share my slides. Let's see. Is good? Cool. I assume that someone will unmute and scream if something stops working at any part of the presentation.
I promise I will.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm glad I can rely on you. So this presentation is about really my trying to take the work that I've been doing for the past decade in focusing on cybersecurity for primarily reporters, but also other at-risk people, and try to summarize what that actually looks like in, I would say, about 30 minutes or so, and then we'll jump into a little discussion with Elodie and a Q&A. And the very last slide of this deck will have a bunch of links. You'll have access to the slides after as well. So if there's anything in here that you want to follow up on, you want to chat with me about, feel free to reach out. So I'm originally from Oslo. I've been in New York since 2016. Like I said, I've been sort of working on cybersecurity for reporters and at-risk people for about a decade, starting with the Tor project back in 2009, later doing some work with Freedom of the Press Foundation. I built the newsroom security program at the New York Times and was there for about 3.5 years. Since then, I've been, and currently I'm still, an advisor to Ford Foundation and the Cybersecurity Infrastructure Security Agency, or CISA. And then in June of this year, I started Granite, which is my own company, to just continue doing this type of work. And slight sidebar, during the pandemic, I also started a Instagram account / now a Substack newsletter to document cases of journalists and spies. So it sort of looks like this, where I profile very briefly an individual who is either a spy using journalism as a cover for espionage, or a journalist who then also turned out to either actually be a spy or at the very least to some extent help law enforcement, help the intelligence agencies. So if that's content that you're interested in, please do like and subscribe and share. So looking back at sort of how I got into the work that I'm doing now, I would say that a lot of it started when I found the Tor project through Google Summer of Code back in 2009. So Google Summer of Code is a program in which Google gives funding to a certain number of nonprofit open source projects so that they can take on summer interns. And so Tor Project was part of this back in 2009. And when I first heard about Tor, I just thought it was really cool that you could use lines of code to be anonymous online. Here was a piece of software that allowed you to browse anonymously. And I did not consider what else you could use the software for. I didn't consider the impact that it could have on other people or the different types of people around the world that could really benefit from the software. And so it was really through those 4 years with the Tor project where I really got to meet journalists, activists, lawyers, security researchers, law enforcement, that I really got to see just the impact that the Tor project has in the world. And through my involvement with the Tor project, just how much impact I could have and the way that I could leverage my knowledge and my passion for technology and for cybersecurity. Over the years, we've also seen Tor sort of evolved from this kind of clunky, a bit hard to use piece of software to now being relatively straightforward to use. It looks just like Firefox. Some additional pieces of software have been developed to complement it, like OnionShare, which allows two people to anonymously, in some cases, or at least securely, using the Tor network, share files. SecureDrop, which allows media organizations to anonymously receive confidential tips from the public, and EOTK, or the Enterprise Onion Toolkit by Alec Muffet, that makes it really, really easy to set up any regular website as an Onion site or as a, as an Onion service. So the New York Times, the BBC has one, the Guardian now has one, the CIA is even on the dark web. And so the way that people have sort of used Tor has certainly sort of shifted a bit over the years. The way that people talk about Tor has shifted a lot. And I've also seen this big shift in this narrative from back in the day where people will say, well, if you're using Tor, or if you're actually encrypting your traffic, then that must mean that you have something to hide. I don't have anything to hide, so I don't need that type of technology. And I think over the years, that has sort of shifted to, we all now have something to protect. I'm not entirely clear on exactly when that shifted. It could have been 2013, 2014, around the Snowden revelations. I know that he sort of used this argument a lot as well, but certainly we're now talking more often about having something to protect and end-to-end encryption sort of being the new default, where people know what to expect from new apps coming onto the market. So if a messaging application is rolled out today and does not have the type of encryption and privacy and security features that we've just come to expect, that's not necessarily an app that we're going to use. And so it's been really, really interesting to sort of see how things have shifted. And this then also maps to the work that I'm doing. So I'll get into that in a bit. So why work with journalists? George Orwell said that journalism is printing what someone else does not want published. Everything else is just public relations. I think there's part of that I really enjoy, because in part I've always been curious and interested in at least knowing how to do things that I'm not supposed to do. And so I think that there's something about journalism and investigative journalism and holding people accountable that just really resonates with me. But I do think that as a result, journalism is also inherently risky work, both online and offline. I mean, we do constantly hear about journalists that are physically assaulted, detained, arrested, in some cases killed. They're targeted with spyware. They're targeted with private spies. This is not something that is rare. These are things that we can hear about every single day. I think it's also really important to note that different people have different concerns and needs and threats. So an individual who's very familiar with technology and with security and who's based in the United States will have very different needs and perhaps also very different questions than, say, an individual who's reporting out of Beijing and may not be as familiar or comfortable with different types of encryption apps or VPNs or something like that, which means that when you engage with a journalist or a team of reporters on a project, you really need to figure out where everyone's at. What do they know? What are they comfortable with? What actually maps to the work that they're doing? And then try to sort of figure that out. As I really like to view it as a puzzle. It's sort of like, given all the technology that is out there today, all the new tools that we can use, combined then with humans and human behavior, what is then the sort of right balance between really, really secure and really, really usable and perhaps not as secure? So for that project, that story, that trip, that office, what is sort of going to be the perfect combination between those two? For example, the physical office of, let's say, the Washington Post in Moscow will have different concerns and different sort of like a different threat model than, say, a bureau in Paris. And that's just another thing to sort of take into account. There's also this need to build a lot of trust to identify usable solutions. I think historically, the sort of one type of guidance that's been given to people around phishing has been, do not click on links from people that you don't know. But in a journalism context, that argument really falls apart because that is exactly how journalists engage with the public. Right? That is, they have to click on links from people they don't know. That's how they receive tips. And so working with journalists then means that you need to find a way to make that safe. You need to find a way to allow them to do these things, which are inherently risky and sometimes insecure or perhaps not ideal, to enable them to do the work that they're doing. And so all of that combined is sort of really, for me, at the core of why I really like this type of work. So over the years, I've sort of seen the work that I do as, I sort of started off seeing it as like just cybersecurity for reporters. And then over the years, that has sort of shifted to the way that I talk about it now is that my role, my job is to help you do your work safely. And what does that now mean? To me, that means physical safety, digital security, emotional safety, and also legal safety. And that working safely as a journalist, you do really need to account for all those buckets. You can't just like be really, really secure from a physical perspective, but ignore the other buckets because at some point, something is going to start falling apart. And I think this is a really, really good example to like drive that home. So this is a story from, if I remember correctly, 2012. If you don't remember the story, John McAfee, the creator of the McAfee antivirus, he'd been living in Belize for some period of time. At one point, his neighbor was found dead. Police really wanted to interview McAfee in relation to their investigation. He instead decided to go on a run and was hiding out in the jungle in, I think, Guatemala, while also tweeting about this entire adventure. And at some point in time, two reporters from Vice went to Guatemala into the jungle to meet with him and to interview him for this article. And they took this photo that you see here and shortly after published that on the Vice homepage. What also had happened was that in publishing this photo, they had not removed the metadata in the photo, which then gave away the date and time the photo was taken and also the location of where the photo was taken. I think people very quickly noticed it. People started tweeting about it. Wired wrote this article. And I think Vice also fairly quickly cleaned things up on their end. But to me, in sort of looking at this now, that sort of brings up questions to me around, well, how did Vice prepare for this trip? So, you know, thinking about journalism, security, and safety as physical, digital, emotional, and legal, here you've got two reporters who are going to travel from presumably the United States to Guatemala. So they have to get flights, they have to bring some gear, maybe they need visas, a bit unclear. They need probably a car, right? They're going into the jungle, they're meeting with this guy who may or may not be slightly unhinged. Like, from a physical security standpoint, there's a lot of different things to consider in that context when we're talking about international travel. So that's one piece of it. Digital security, there's the questions around, like, what kind of gear are they bringing? Is it new? Are they bringing burner phones? What do they do with any photo or video? Do they make sure that metadata is removed from the photos that they're taking? From an emotional safety standpoint, there's sort of questions around, it could be fairly stressful to go on this type of trip. Like, do they talk about it beforehand? Do they talk about it amongst themselves? Is there sort of any debrief when they come back? That's also a bit unclear. And then from a legal standpoint, we are talking about two US reporters going to another country to interview a man who is wanted for questioning by law enforcement in another country. I am sure that that would have brought up some legal questions as well. And so when I think of journalism security and the way that I approach my work, this is sort of a really, really good example of the different things that I would consider in that context. So part of what I try to focus on, right, is that good security requires understanding the risks associated with the work that you're doing. And so thinking about the tools that I would use every day and that I would recommend that people use every day would be unique passwords. So have a password manager, two-factor authentication on all accounts, use full disk encryption, make sure you install all of your software updates. And that should really be this like security baseline that's just like present at all times by default. And then from there, depending on who you are, what your threat model is like, what it is that you're trying to achieve, how comfortable you are with different types of technical solutions, you can sort of explore from there and figure out what makes the most sense. Because there's like I said, there's a lot of neat technical solutions out there, like tails and cubes and burner phones, but not everyone will need or understand those tools, right? So over the years, whenever I've encountered like a new piece of technology, like tails or the concept of burner phones that sort of popped up years ago, I try it out for myself in a different context, just to see how it works and also to figure out how it doesn't work. And if it's something that I can use that does not introduce too much friction for me, then that is something that I am then comfortable suggesting to other people. Because I want to be able to say, you know, hey, if you're going to country so-and-so, I do recommend that you have a travel phone, but for a travel phone, here are the things that you would need to consider and the things that you'd need to set up beforehand. And I would know that because I've done it before. And I also then have a good sense of any sort of pitfalls that you may run into. Like, I have found myself in a different country with a travel laptop and a travel phone without the two-factor codes I needed to get onto my social media accounts. So that suppose is tiny bit more boring than what it could have been, right? And that was just something that I hadn't thought through that beforehand. I hadn't made that plan. And so a lot of what goes into security for at-risk people is that, again, that sort of everyday baseline, the everyday steps that really anyone should take, whether at risk or not. And then after that, just figuring out what is the right balance between like really technical and really secure, and what is going to be, in that case, good enough for that individual. And then I also wanted to, just keeping a track of time, okay, we're good. There's this fantastic article in The Intercept published in 2019 by Michael Lee called The Metadata Trap, where it's a fairly long read, but is a really, really good one because it takes different cases of US whistleblowers and then looks into what we know about how the government began their leak investigation and what that investigation looked like and to what extent metadata played a part in that investigation. And so in some cases, it does talk about Reality Winner. It talks about a woman who had provided some information to BuzzFeed and a couple of other cases. And you really, really get to see that like just using encrypted messaging is not necessarily sufficient if you're not also considering the way in which metadata is gathered, the way that that information can be provided to law enforcement, the way that that then can be leveraged in a leak investigation, for example. And so again, securing reporters, but also any sort of like at-risk group of people, whether it's asylum seekers or activists or people seeking abortions in the United States these days, I think metadata is definitely something to consider as well. And I think it is a risk that people should be aware of and that we should talk about more. And yes, it is different. Like going into a traditional enterprise news organization, you'll find that security typically at any company, I would say, is often overwhelmed and under-resourced. So when I joined the New York Times in 2016, the Times had a CISO, the Times had a security team focusing on sort of traditional enterprise security type work. But there wasn't anyone there dedicated to the questions that would come from the newsroom. And of course they could like research and figure things out, but that would also mean setting aside some other really important work that they had to do. And so it is different. The way that you'd approach this type of work, I think at a media organization is different than your typical traditional security role. Engaging with people in a newsroom, you really do have to be willing to listen and win friends and influence people. It's certainly not an environment that sort of likes to be told what to do. You can't necessarily enforce things through policy. You really do have to help people understand what you're there to do, what your goal is, and how you're going to achieve that, and also for them to see that you are there to support the work that they're doing. There's also typically then, I think, and maybe this is shifting in different organizations now, but where some security teams will be fairly reactive. So if they get an email with a question, they'll respond. If the help desk receives a ticket for someone needing a travel laptop, they'll respond. If there's a security incident, they'll respond. But I've always argued that in this specific context, working with reporters, you do have to be a bit more proactive, because I don't think that it should be all on the journalists to know which tools they need at what point in time, or when they would need a travel laptop, or when they would need a travel phone. I think part of this type of work also means proactively letting them know, hey, here are the different cases when this could be helpful to you. here's how you would use it, and here's how you would request it from the help desk, for example. Another interesting use case that often pops up is security teams at companies typically secure or focus on corporate assets, corporate systems, corporate accounts. But journalists are journalists 24/7 and will also sort of do their work across personal accounts like social media. And so if and when something happens to a journalist's personal Twitter account, for example, Twitter as a company will consider that account a personal account. And in many ways, yes, it is a personal account, but the journalist's identity and the employer, the media organization, does have a stake at that point in time as well. So it becomes this like really interesting balance and discussion internally just around like how far can we and should we and do we go to protect people, even as that extends onto their personal accounts and devices and etc. So pausing there, I wanted to just say a couple of things about just how people could get involved with this type of work. Is I have a bachelor's degree in information security. I didn't really get into any of this type of work until I found the TOR project in 2009. And then it just sort of evolved from there. There's now more focus on this type of work. I think it may be a bit easier to get involved with now as it's sort of become a bit more established. So I would say that number one, Google Summer of Code is still around. I think that they typically do announce new enrollment period or application period in maybe March or April next year for work next summer. So definitely take a look, see if there's any work there that you could get involved with. If you remember crypto parties, where we would all get together in person and talk about cryptography and Signal and WhatsApp and disappearing messages and threat models. That was a big thing a few years ago. I think the pandemic might have killed them. We should definitely bring them back. I think it's a great way to both connect with people in your community, to share your knowledge, to learn a lot, and also just a fun social event. Organizations like the TOR Project, you know, the Press Foundation, the EFF are all hiring from time to time. They even do take on summer interns, so definitely check that out. There are big tech companies now that do put a bit more focus on securing at-risk people. Just look at Apple and lockdown mode that was just rolled out in iOS 16 and macOS Ventura. Going to a big tech company does not have to mean that you do not get to do important work for at-risk people. So I'll just put that out there as well. And I think that is the last slide. Yes. So I'll just pause on this slide. Again, has a bunch of links from the stuff that we talked about. You'll have access to the deck as well. And I hope that was helpful. If you have any questions, I think you can plug it in the chat and Elodie and Saul and I will get to it.
Awesome, thank you, Runa. So let's bring on Elodie Vialle, who we've already introduced a little bit, but again, former Knight Wallace Fellow, currently a Berkman Fine Fellow, and also an advocate for freedom of journalistic expression and journalistic safety. So there to do a little bit of a Q&A. Audience, please don't be shy. Put questions in the Q&A. As they have their conversation, we'll be sifting through questions. And towards the end, about 15, 20 minutes from now, if not even a little earlier, we'll start shuffling in questions that you have. So don't be shy. Thanks. And I'll turn it back over to you two.
Thank you so much, Saul. And I want to thank Runa for all the great work she does, because as a journalist working for organizations supporting journalists, I do know that all these tools and this risk assessment and these safety trainings and this approach are very, it's more than helpful. It enables journalists to do their work. And of course, the New York Times and all the work you've done, you did at the New York Times, surely set up the standards internationally on what's it's done within newsrooms. So thank you so much. I really appreciate also your holistic approach, let's say, to safety. I think we have to stop working in silos, like cybersecurity folks and HR team working on legal threats, and we have some therapists there working on the emotional impact, while all the journalists, you know, they suffer from nervous breakdowns and when they are not attacked physically. So we have a lot of measures, let's say, things we do in newsrooms, but all these things have to be implemented, yes, in a more holistic way. And this is exactly what Runa does. So I really appreciate this approach. I want to say that it's very new also for newsrooms to talk about the emotional impact of all these things, while a lot of journalists are not feeling good. And I want to go back in a minute in all the digital stuff, because we're here for that, right? But it's really important to see these legal threats also, because all these digital attacks are all this digital safety train aspect we have to take into consideration are part of an array of attacks against journalists. Runa mentioned this, but you have the physical attacks, journalists put in jail, and it's this all happens where suffer from political pressure, economical pressure. A lot of newsrooms are just struggling right now to survive from an economical standpoint. And this is why safety and cybersecurity is clearly not the priority, which is what exactly put all these folks at risk. Because we have so many things, problems to deal with, cybersecurity cannot be one. So a lot of folks try to organize themselves, for instance, to face the legal threats. OCCRP, the Organized Crime and Corruption Reporting Project, recently created an insurance, a co-op, because insurances company, they don't want to cover journalists, because it's like it's just too dangerous, you know. Investigative journalists working on accountability of governments on topics like corruption in the world, they gathered and they say, yeah, we're going to create our own insurance, you know, and this is what they did. It's a community effort. And I really appreciated also, Runa, when you've mentioned the need to find a balance every time. And this is why we need cybersecurity experts. We understand what we do as journalists. I personally work, my research is focused on online harassment of journalists, which is a rising threat to journalists. A lot of journalists are harassed online, insulted, they receive death threats. This is sometimes organized by governments. And when I mention this, and a lot of journalists are traumatized because of this, they refrain themselves from covering certain stories. And journalists with marginalized identities are more targeted. Women are more targeted. LGBTQ folks are more targeted. Black journalists are more targeted by these attacks. And when we mention this, people tell us, but you just have to disconnect from social media. Don't use Facebook. Don't use Twitter. Okay. But we cannot do that. We cannot, as a journalist, I need to be visible. I need to be on Twitter. I need to be on Facebook. I need to use all these tools. And I don't have like 24 hours to think about a strategy on how to be visible while being safe and so on. I don't have all the time. So I really appreciate this mindset to say we have to find a balance. We have to find a way to stay secure in a hostile environment, and how can we make it like quick? Because so I think it's really important to maybe like think about all this and how we can maybe Runa, I would love to ask you a question about how can we better design all these tools, like because I'm not since the beginning, because we have a lot of hostile environments actually online for journalists. And how could it be possible to implement all this approach, this risk assessment approach for people at risk online, like journalists, since the beginning, not at the end when we have to cover things and we, I don't know if you get my question.
I think I do. I think it's a really good question. And I'm also really, really glad that you brought up the part about online threats and harassment, something that I didn't really cover and has sort of now been like yet another bucket, if you will, yet another type of threat to consider. And I think it just sort of goes to show, like, I've been on Twitter for 10 years, right? The way that I use Twitter today is very, very different than the way that I used Twitter 10 years ago. And just the conversations have shifted, the rhetoric has shifted, the way that people talk to each other now has sort of shifted. And in response, there are companies like Block Party that are creating tools specifically for Twitter that will make it a bit easier for you to like mute accounts, figure out how to process potential threats, potential harassment. It will save things on a lockout folder in case you do have to report something to law enforcement. I think part of it, I think in an ideal world, yes, all the good trust and safety features will just sort of be implemented by default in the products. But I also think that part of the challenge is that we are sometimes a bit slow to talk about the challenges that we are facing and figure out, well, now that we're aware of this, what do we do moving forward? So one example that I now see implemented in more newsrooms is sort of like a trust and safety working group where you do have representatives from physical security, digital, legal, corporate communications, HR, social media, to talk about the challenges that they're facing across the board, and to your point, come up with that from the get-go holistic solution. So it's not just like reactive ad hoc chaos every single time something happens.
Yes, we try. The point you address is really important. Is when we talk here about two layers, like individuals and institutions, organizations. And I think it's really important to think about what kind of policies and protocols do we implement within institutions. And we talk a lot about journalists, but all you work with users at risk, so all users, right? And so I like the idea of working and bringing together like everyone and the top management within institutions, because it's really important. Also, I want to mention this, we try to do a lot of work on freelancers and independent journalists, because today they are the most at risk. They expose themselves, you know, when you cover something and you're a freelancer, you don't know if the newsroom is going to hire you for this contract. So you take more risk, right? And you're not covered if anything happens. And of course, as organizations supporting journalists, as folks supporting journalists, we try to advocate the newsrooms and the institution to say, hey, you have to cover these journalists for that. But they don't always do this. So the question is, maybe how do we move forward on this discussion with at the same time with institutions and with individuals? What are what is the method and the incentives?
I definitely think that there needs to be a focus on both. When I work with institutions on creating a policy or a process or whatever it is that the engagement covers for their staff, I do focus on the individuals in that newsroom. But I also do bring up this question of like, you do have freelancers, right? You have contractors that you work with. To what extent is the work that we're doing over here right now extend to these people? And sometimes the answer is absolutely, we'll make sure that they get a copy of this as well. We'll make sure that they have access to the same resources. Sometimes that's just not something that they've thought about. When I do speak with freelancers who are working on stories for established media organizations, I will tell them, hey, I know that company so-and-so does have an established security team. I know that you can request to speak to them if you do have any concerns, or if you do have any needs around like needing a travel laptop or something like that. So I think it's just part of it is also just on one end, helping the institutions understand what this landscape actually looks like now and what people need. Because like I said, it has sort of shifted over the years, and maybe they don't know, maybe they haven't actually considered it. And also to let the freelancers know, like, here's what you can expect and here's what you can ask for. And in many ways, giving them permission to go and ask for the things that they need.
Maybe before we jump to the question, I'm just curious about when it comes to safety, there's a lack of diversity of profiles within the field. I don't know if you agree with that. And you're kind of rock star in the field, you know, because you did so much for journalists and other folks. How do you think how can we bring a more diverse security trainers, security advisors, more women, more LGBTQ folks, and more people of color? Because today, when I did a lot of security trainings, and most of the time, the folks who do that are former military, and they feel that something's not okay. They need to bring new trainers to be more maybe legit or whatever. And how do we make sure that the people who are in charge of security also reflect the diversity of our society and of the newsrooms?
It is a really, really good point. And I agree, a lot of the people that you typically see doing physical security in the media space are white men, former military. And I think that one way to start shifting that is that you do now have different communities, whether online or through conferences, that sort of meet, whether it's to talk about trust and safety, to talk about disinformation in news, to talk about cybersecurity, to talk specifically about cybersecurity for at-risk people. And I do think that if you're looking to hire from a more diverse group of people, you need to actually do the outreach to find them first. And so I think that specifically reaching out to these communities and connecting with the people there, I would say is a good first step, because they're definitely there. So it's just, you do just have to put the effort in as the person hiring.
And from your own experience, would you have any advice for folks or participants today who would like to work in the field?
I think definitely Google Summer Code would be one way to sort of get involved with the TOR project. Freedom of the Press Foundation, EFF are hiring. There are ways to volunteer as well with these organizations. There are conferences, Access Now puts on one that I would say is probably in the spring. So I think that there are sort of more resources out there now to find ways to just slowly start to get involved.
Thank you. Thank you. I think we have, around 15 minutes left, so we can take maybe some questions.
All right. So great conversation. And we do have a number of questions queued up for you all. So I'll be sharing them in no particular order. So An audience member asks, given how individualized journalistic protection seems to be, how can you make a large scale difference at a tech company other than safety specific ones? In other words, if you are working for a Google or an Amazon or whoever, what can you do? How can you do your part?
So I think on one end, for those bigger companies, there may be ways that you can volunteer within your working hours. There are likely donation match initiatives throughout the year. If you are working specifically on projects, like let's say like you're developing a new feature for like iOS or for Google, then yes, you will have to consider how this is going to scale and how this is going to have an impact on a larger group of people. But I do think that in even in those cases, there are ways that you can like do outreach. You can talk to people who are in these different communities. You can figure out what's working well for them or what they need, what's not working, and then sort of find ways then to identify like what are needs that would apply to a large number of people that would be something that you could then pitch internally and work on. Elodie, do you want to add anything to that?
No, I think we can take other questions. Thank you.
So I'm going to combine a couple of questions. So an audience member asked, what phone, OS, and instant messaging app combination are you recommending to journalists who have reason to fear their governments? And that could be context specific to Russia, could be the United States, but that's, could you take it from answering for the journalist specifically, but also what should we as everyday citizens, what tools and combo of apps might you recommend for us?
So my sort of standard initial recommendation would be Signal and WhatsApp, and then talk about the differences between the two, which primarily comes down to WhatsApp does collect and store more metadata around your use of the application. Signal does not. So that's sort of where I start. And then there are people that use Telegram in different parts of the world. The EFF has this great article about harm reduction for Telegram users in Russia and Ukraine, which I think applies to people around the world, really, that just outlines, here's this app. If you want to use it, here's what you should know. And I think that that is a fantastic approach, because in some cases, you'll be talking to an individual who is either not familiar with, does not trust, or whose friends just aren't using the app that you're trying to recommend. And sometimes there will then be apps that people are using that you don't necessarily trust for whatever reason. And I think at that point, it's just a matter of communicating to them, what are the pros and cons of this app? What do we know? What do we don't know? How do you go about using this app as safely as possible? But yeah, going back to my personal choice, it would be Signal as number one and WhatsApp number two.
And Elodie, what about you? What tools do you use in your everyday life that are more privacy protecting or secure?
Yes, we use password managers, Signal as well. And it's really important, as mentioned by Runa several times, to do a specific risk assessment, taking into consideration the context you're working in, because it can depend on the country and on even on the report you're working on. But personally, I use Signal as well.
So Elodie, before we get to some other questions, I just had one for you that I want you to share a little bit about your own journey. So when did you realize you wanted to pivot away from sort of doing the journalistic work to being more of a journalistic advocate and an advocate for freedom of of journalistic expression and securing journalists.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I worked in journalism and I became a consultant for newsroom. And a decade ago, I helped newsrooms in the world to be more digital, let's say, and to produce new editorial product and digital product to train their teams. But I was like, what's the point of doing all this work if people are not even free to produce, to publish what they want to publish? They're intimidated, they're threatened, they're attacked. So this is how I started working on press freedom for Reporters Without Borders, first in Paris. And now I work mainly for PEN America, an organization supporting writers and journalists in the US and in the world. And so I worked on, I was a digital safety trainer. But then I became a tech policy advocate as well. And let's say working with the, talking with the platform, having discussion with the platform, the social media platforms, to try to make them, their tools safer for journalists, and in particular journalists arrest online, as I mentioned. And so I see that someone is a chat is asking about how can we better support marginalized groups online. And there's so first of all, yes, yeah, so sorry, I replied, I jumped to this question that I want to take. Yeah, I, you know, the journalists, we choose the questions. Yes, this is it. So so what we can do, so first of all, I would like to share with you, I don't know how, the PEN America resources. We were produced an online harassment field manual. It's a very complete manual to be better prepared and respond to online harassment. We also have the digital safety snacks, short videos to take measures step by step to better protect yourself online. So that's one thing you can do to better protect yourself online. It's really important also, as Runa mentioned, if you go and work in the field, if you're a computational scientist, data scientist, engineer, project manager, whatever you do, you will do tomorrow, to keep all these conversations in mind. And when it comes to producing and working on new products, you know, I've discovered recently what red teams are actually when it comes to producing a project. Like, you have to play like you're your own adversary, right? And I really would like the tech company to implement, let's say, to include, to be more inclusive, to include civil society folks and journalists within their red teams when they, before launching any new product. So this will be a way to build a safer internet. And this will be a way to better support marginalized communities, because we cannot work this way. Like, we produce something, then it has like collateral damages on democratic processes and journalists and people at risk. And then we say, oh, how are we going to fix the problem? Well, my suggestion is, let's work together before everything, before the problem happens, you know, and let's co-design together these tools. And please include folks like us, journalists, civil society, security advisors, into the teams when you work on this kind of product. So that's my big answer to this question.
So for both of you,
can I just add something? Yeah. Sorry, Sal. Yeah. I just wanted to sort of add that I've been talking about journalism security for a long time, for years. Like, I write about it, I tweet about it, I make funny memes about it. Like, it's not something that I just like woke up yesterday and like said, and then Saul reached out and like invited Elodie and I to sort of have a chat here, right? This is sort of the type of work that we've been doing very consistently over a long period of time. And I think that that is just key to a lot of advocacy work is that you just really have to truly believe in what you're doing and just keep on talking about it. And eventually other people will catch on and you'll build a community around that. Sorry,
you've both given wonderful descriptions of how sort of better building this into whether it's technology, processes, journalistic practices. Can either of you share, without oversharing names or even organizations, where this has paid off for you? Where is there, do you have an example of a journalist that was protected or had a threat actor thwarted or a harasser removed because of the guidance and the tools that you all have been using and advocating for?
I would flip that around and say that I know that I have done my job well when a reporter is successfully going to report on whatever it is that they want to report on, and that article comes out and they get great feedback and they feel like they're supported the whole way through.
Elodie, any thought on that one?
How do we measure the impact of our work? Is that what you mean, so in a way?
How do you measure it? Or even is there an example to really make tangible that this is important for journalists, that they need to be protected from harassment, that they need to have these tools in place because otherwise their lives or their careers or their families even are at risk?
This is important for journalists, but this is important for all of us. If journalists cannot do their work, imagine a world where you have no access to any trusted information, no access to reliable information. Because even if people are not really a huge fan of journalists nowadays, journalists comply with method, ethics, and deontology, and to produce what they do. And the journalistic processes are the only way to get access to reliable information. And with citizen journalists in some countries where it's difficult to have independent outlets, but we need journalists to keep living in democracies. So that's why we try so hard to protect this specific population, because we think that we cannot be free, we cannot be informed, we cannot keep living in democracies if we don't get journalists. And this is why we cannot disconnect all the tech work we're doing on one end to this thinking on the other end. We have to say, okay, how I'm going to work consistently, how I'm going to produce tools that are okay for journalists and all folks who are targeted online. I want to be very I see that time's up, but there's a questions about, which is very important, I think, about the misuse of all what we do. Like every time we create a tool and a feature, or we think about these things, it can potentially be misused in a way exactly to intimidate the people we intend to protect. That there's a question in the chat, how do you rectify this less desirable use of secure technology? Maybe Runa, you and Sol, you have an answer to that, because that's a very important point. And every time we suggest an idea, people tell this.
Right. It's the question was about, you know, Tor and Signal, and these things are wonderful because they are very secure, but they can also be used by groups that perhaps misuse them to either attack or abuse the very population that we're trying to protect, or in other ways. And unfortunately, my unfortunate answer is this is part of the tech game. You know, this is what can be used for good can also be misused. And that's part of technology legacy overall.
I would say the very, very short answer is that you cannot design something that is secure only for one group of people. And for more on that, go check out Alec Muffet and his work on end-to-end encryption and his really, really good paper on what end-to-end encryption actually means. And it really does also sort of touch on this idea that you can't have security just for one group of people, but not others.
So, you know, that we're a couple minutes over and then we continue to get questions is telling about how engaging the topic is, how important the topic is. I want to thank Runa and Elodie, the ITS organizing team, and you, the audience, for your participation and engagement. I hope you learned as much as I did today. And just a reminder, this public engagement is part of our mission at the University of Michigan. So I hope Summit 22 did its part to serve the U of M community and beyond. Stay tuned for more from ITS, as there'll be additional entries in our Leadership in Technology and Distinguished Lecture Series. Data Privacy Day/Month is coming up in January, and dissonance events will continue as along the way. Thank you all again. Have a great day. Thank you for staying with us. We'll be posting Runa's slides as well as working with Elodie to get some of the links she referred to. Have a wonderful day. Thank you, everybody.